Hi, my name is Evgenii Ray, and I work as a front-end engineer. I created this course because UI engineers need to understand the fundamentals of system design to build complex large-scale apps. In this course, I will cover the fundamentals of how the browser works, DOM API, the Observer API, and how to build virtual lists, application state pattern, networking patterns, performance optimization. And in the end, we'll do a mock system design interview building a social newsfeed. With this knowledge, you'll be able to understand how to build scalable web applications.
So let's have a quick example of the non-optimized pipeline where we utilize the style, layout, paint, and composite phase and optimized pipeline. So we need to open the code sandbox example. So right now we're rendering 2000 rectangles on a screen. And the idea is right now the page is using optimized pipeline. So we mostly utilize the GPU. And as you can see, there is no lag on the screen. So we are getting our 60 FPS and we can measure the performance by going to the performance tab. And now we can try to see how much CPU is loaded. So we can run the quick snapshot. And that should be enough. So if we look at the CPU here, so we utilize 0% of CPU. So it basically, it's a flat line. But we can switch this to the non-optimized pipeline. So let's try to run the snapshot now. And you see the buffer is complete, is filled in 3 seconds. See, now the CPU is loaded. And the thing is, this Mac is 16 cores, but you don't have the 16 cores M2 Max on every device. And if we throttle the CPU here, you will see that CPU will work hard just to move this 2000 rectangles. The difference in the pipeline, sometimes the code difference is very small. So if we look how everything is built, it's just two lines. If we apply the margin top property in animation, then what the browser does, it needs to recalculate the position of every element, like of all 2000 rectangles to render the frame. While we apply the translate Y function, it only moves the pixels. It basically draws, it's used only the GPU just to draw a new pixel set because the CSS transformation, they do not utilize CPU. So this section will be very like coding heavy. We're going to explore, we're going to utilize the Intersection Observer to create a very simple version of infinite scroller where you just load the content once you're intersecting with the bottom observer. So there's no virtualization yet here, but it's a prerequisite exercise for the virtualization part. So let's go to the exercise. And here we have our exercise. So we're going to reuse the same card component that we're currently that we used before, and we already have everything set up, and we have our mock init database that we're going to use to generate the data. So what it does, it takes the object as a sample and just returns similar objects to us, and then we already have the query selector that selects the list container where we will put all our cards. And also the bottom observer. And if we run this page to see how it looks like, we'll see that here is our bottom observer. And now it doesn't do anything because we need to implement this. So let's get back to the code now. So our goal first is to initiate the intersection observer. So let's create one instance here. OK, so now we need to provide the callback. The callback accepts entries. And then we also need to provide the configuration. So I'll set up the threshold of 0.2, and I'm OK to use the viewport as the intersection route. So now we need to handle our entries. Since I know that we have only one intersection entry, so I can destruct the array and have single entry here. So I don't need to loop for that. So now we can check if the entry is intersecting. The next step is to fetch a new data. So let's fetch a new data using our MockDB. So let's convert this callback to a synchronous one and then use await on our DB. And then we have a method called getPage. The getPage accepts the pointer, which is the page number. So let's create one variable that will start with a zero. And then every time we execute the callback, we're going to increase it by one. OK, now we have our data. So we need to convert this data to HTML elements. So we can create a new fragment to accumulate all the DOM mutations we're planning to do. So we create a new document fragment. And now we're going to loop for the data. And we are going to create the card using our create card function. And then we are going to pass datum title and datum body. So now we created our card element. We want to add this card element to our fragment. So we use fragment append child card. We updated our fragment, so we now accumulate all the DOM updates within this in-memory object. And once we finished updating the fragment, we can finally append the element to our list, which we already queried. So let's use list, append child, fragment. So instead of having, for instance, 10 operations, we now just have one. And now the intersection observer is ready. We need to observe the element that we're trying to observe. So let's use observer, observe, and provide our element, which is already here, observer element. So, and if we run this in the browser, so now we have our cards perfectly rendered. And when we go down, we render more data. So let's get the practical kind of example. So we have the Messenger app where we render the contact list. And each contact has a conversation where we can have thousands of messages potentially. So how would you optimize that? So the most obvious approach would be just to put everything into the context state and the global state. But there is a problem with that. So if you want to access a contact with ID Jane Smith and we want to find any message with ID 5, then we're going to do two hoops. First, we're going to filter out the contacts. Then we're going to filter out the messages. So this is although acceptable, it's still not the best way, because if we have potentially thousands of messages, then we need to traverse the whole array just to access single element. This is not the way we want to design our app. And so the first technique that we can use to optimize our data is to change how we store it. And there is a concept called data normalization. So the data normalization has been around for, I think, 20 or 30 years already. So it's a concept used in the databases heavily. The goals of data normalization is to provide optimized access performance and also provide the optimized structure how we store the data. And if we have a unified structure how we store things in a state, it increases the readability of our code and further maintenance. So if we take the first example where we have a simple object with the ID and name, and then it has the job and the location. So right now, it's a non-normalized object. So we can optimize this by applying the first normal form. And what the first normal form does is tells us that every field on your object should be atomic. So we need to convert to reduce any nesting in our objects. So we just flatten the nested objects here. So the job object becomes the job ID and job title, and the location becomes country code and the country name. Also, the first normal form tells us that They should be the primary key. And we know that we already have the primary key, which is the ID that we can utilize. So the next, we can convert our first normal form to the second normal form. And what the second normal form does, it tells us that all our fields now should ideally should depend on the entity. So if we look at the following fields, the job ID and job title, the job title actually depends on the job ID, although it also depends on the on our user object. So the data normalization tells us that we need to decouple this into the separate table in the database concept, but in our case, it will be the separate object. So we move our jobs, we move our job to the jobs table. Now we have the key, which is the UIE, is a as a job ID, and now we have the information relevant to this job. And we also normalize the user jobs, so we can access what type of job the user has by providing the ID. So this is now all our entities depend on the primary key.